But in this video, I would like to share with you my experience of working for the NHS, how's I fulfill my duty as a rotational pharmacist and as a band 6 pharmacist. I want to share some hints and tips so that you can visualize if you are applying for band 6 or band 7 pharmacist post. Standard hours will be 37 and a half. So you work from 9 to 5:30 and you're given 1 hour lunch break. To start with, we would have a team huddle in the morning when all the pharmacists and medicine assistants and technicians will gather to divide what ward we'll be covering. So with that, have that team huddle first thing in the morning. So I would be designated to cover a ward, which is elderly ward or surgical ward, or could be any ward based on the staff availability on the day. After knowing which way you could be going, there will be a handover from the previous day to pass on anything to follow up, anything to chase. So we have that communication first thing in the morning. When I get into the ward, I will look at the diary. So on that diary, when we didn't have the electronic ordering, all the staff nurse was writing down what they need and how urgent it would be. Is any IV med that requiring ordering straight away, any TTO. TTO would stand for to take out, or some trust might call it TTA, which is to take away. Needs validating straight away, but now because we have electronic prescribing, you could just go on your laptop and search to see any urgent medication require ordering. So I would do that first thing. From that, you can see any new patient are recently admitted overnight, any patients on medication require your immediate attention, like Parkinson medication, epilepsy, diabetic medication, or any patient on insulin, to make sure that you order them in a timely manner. Doesn't cause any missed doses because it could actually affect patients' outcome as well. So I would do that first thing. That's also helped me prioritize what patient I could see first. So after all that, after look at the diary, after seeing what patient I need to see, then if I have time, I like to join in the meeting, the ward meeting in the morning. So on that meeting, you see all the doctors, all the nurses, all the discharge liaison officer, doing handover team to see, you know, how patient has improved overnight, any communications needed. So I try to join that at least once a week. So if I'm being moved to a new ward, I like to have that discussion so I can familiarize myself with what patients do they see, any difficult patient, any patient required immediate attention. And then the next task will be, if I don't have to do any validating TTO, then I will just see new patients. Sometimes I'm given a medicine technician with me, so she could just carry on med recking while I'm just doing medication review. But if I'm covering the ward by myself, then I would have to be looking through the patient and see which one I need to see first. As I say before, Parkinson medications, any epilepsy medication, that I would see those patients first to ensure, because not everyone come to the hospital with their supply of medication. So I need to make sure that anything I prescribe or transcribe on the system is correct and they've got the stocks on the ward so the nurse can give it to the patient. Another tip I would want to recommend is always carry a notebook with you when you can document the patient that you see. And it's common that as a band 6 pharmacist, you'll be doing your diploma. So that's 2 years diploma when you learn and specialize more about hospital setting. So it's useful to write down the patient that you will see, because later on you can use those patients for your case-based discussion, for your PCP, which is patient pharmaceutical care plan, and you can discuss with your tutor or any other senior pharmacist. Okay, on that notebook as well, you can also write down all the intervention that you make. For example, how do you avoid a near miss, miss medication? What doses have you changed and how would that be beneficial to the patient? That kind of thing, because down the line, you can reflect upon it and you can use those examples in your interview if you are applying for a new role later on, or if you want to write down your supportive statement. And on that notebook as well, you can write down any references that you can use. References I was using most of the time was renal drug database, IV antibiotic use in hospital settings, so as why any dough changes if they're renal impaired. I have news guidelines, I have a drug compatibility, so if the patient using syringe driver, sometimes the nurse might be asking you, is this compatible with this? You know, you can just quickly flick through it as well. So the thing that you'll be using like most of the time, and not sometimes you don't have phones or laptop available on hand, so having those referenced in your notebook, it quickly access and you can give him the answer straight away. Okay, on the notebook, write down as well the list of number you can contact, the list of number of senior pharmacists. If you've got any questions, you can liaise with them as well. So that, you know, also being part of the junior pharmacy is recognizing what are you competent in, what advice can you give, what can you give, and if you don't know the answer, who do you get in touch to find out about it? So write down those number out because it will come down in handy to you. And then just carry on medreccing. So what is medrec? Medrec is medicine reconciliation, where you would require to have at least two sources of information to ensure the list of medicine prescribed on the system, whether on drug chart or electronic prescribing system, is done correctly. And so the resources that you'll be using is whether SCR, some patient will get their SCR stand for summary care record, some of them will have SCR uploaded straight on CPD, some of them won't be available but will get them printed as well. But speak to the patient first. If they've not been uploaded, ask for their consent before you upload their SCR on the system. And then if the patient's well enough, can you speak to them? So that would be normally be the second source of information. Speak to the patient. Patient know best what medication they take as well, because you know they might be prescribed metformin 1 gram 3 times a day, but they might be just taking 1 gram twice a day, so that technically a trans discrepancy there. And if the doctor just relies on SCR, that's mean patient be taking more than what they needed, so that's why pharmacists would come in handy to ensure that the medicine history is done correctly. So speak to the patient. If the patient is not well, or the patient is deaf of hearing, or if you have any communication barrier that stop you from speaking to the patient, then I would suggest you speak to the patient relative. So get in touch with them. Sometimes would be the wife that normally helping the husband about the medication. Speak to them. What chances are they have a list of what medicines they have at home, so you can speak to them. Third would be some patient would have a medicine in a dosage box, so you can communicate to their community pharmacy, speak to them, and also that also help for to community pharmacy as well, because they might be preparing for the next doses, not knowing patient is in hospital, there might be potential changes into the medication. So speak to them as well, let them know patient is in hospital so they don't have to deliver to the patient, and let them know that you will ring them before the patient going home and communicate to them what changes has happened from this admission. The other thing you can speak to is to speak to their carer. Some patient might have carer that coming to two, three times a week or come in every day that support patient with medication administration. So you could speak to them as well. So there's a variety of sources that you could use, but always trying to aim to have at least two sources of information to ensure that your medicine history is up to date. And also communicate as well with the change of the information that you find. So if the patient have all of their pre-admission medication at home, write down so when you come to the validation, the prescription to go home, you know that you don't have to supply extra because their patient have enough at home. You also write down that anything, like if the patient are not compliant with the medication, have that communication with the GP, write down somewhere so they would trigger the alarm for the GP to do the medication review for the patient. If I'm the only pharmacist on the ward and if I carry medicine history, then I will try not to do the pharmacist review straight away. If I'm covering the ward all day, I will do history first and come back later on to do pharmacist review, looking at it in a fresher approach, because you'll be missing out certain thing, and or maybe you're fixating on one thing and you don't I feel like it's harder for me to review the patient in a holistically approach if I'm just doing med reg and medication review straight away. I have that first, or doing something else, ordering medication, and then do review. Always have that break before you carry on doing your pharmacist review. So what do you do when you do pharmacist review? You look through the books and you see what's the presenting complaint, why patient coming to the hospital, what changes, what their working diagnosis at the moment, what are they treating the patient, and then again later on looking at the drug history that were written by you or by the technician, find out, is this any changes that need to be done? If any, for example, some patient might be nearby now, or and they're taking epilepsy medication, so they won't, any of those need converting into a different form. That's where pharmacists come in handy. You can do, use your magic, you're a medicine expert, that's when you giving your expertise to support the team. So that's kind of thing, looking all the blood. The thing about hospitals is you can get access to all the blood results. We're speaking to the doctor. If you've got any questions, you can come to speak to them. And the trust that I was working, everyone was really friendly. I could just speak to the consultant and learn a lot from them. And you'd be surprised by speaking to them. Sometimes as a pharmacist, we're fixating a lot on a medication. As a doctor, they're looking at the whole picture, and what you see is the first line of treatment might not be relevant to the patient. And that's why team efforts, team communication come along. The next one will be, how would you write down on the patient's notes, how you communicate the recommended changes in a short and sweet manner in the patient's note. So you would write down the date, the time, pharmacist review, what changes have you recommended, and what attention. So is it for the attention of the nurses, or is it for the attention of the doctor? Write down as well, communicate on patient's note, and also communicate in the electronic prescribing as well, because we can create action with that action toward the prescriber or the nurses. Document it as much as you can, because not everyone's available for you. As a first approach, speak to them in person. However, they might not be available on the ward. Anything that's requiring attention, make note of it so you can come back to it. So any, for example, if the patients are having AKI and apixaban is no longer relevant to them, the 5 milligram twice a day is no longer relevant due to AKI, then speak to them directly if you can, then trying to come back later on, but make sure that your message is addressed, is somebody is actively looking to it, because you might not be covering that ward the next day. If you can communicate to the doctor, then speak to the nurse who look after the patient. Ensure that somebody is available, somebody is knowing the message that and how urgent that is. Being a band 7 pharmacist, you also do on call. So let's talk about a bit about on call. So on call is different trusts will have different role, whether you covering the whole week on call at night time when the pharmacy shut, you'll be carrying a phone or a bleed, so that if they have any urgent supply that needs to be done overnight, they will get in touch with you. So you'll be given a briefcase. In that briefcase, they would have a laptop that enables you to get access to the trust internet and have a look at any patient note or electronic chart online, or all the folders and resources available that you can do as well. It was just quite trust, so we didn't have as much on calls. Like some day you've been getting no call. Different trusts will be different. So some trusts like Leeds, as what my friend said, they are really busy. They would have had like at least 20 calls, whether it's medications supply or medication query. The call could be varieties based on the trust. With my experience, it wasn't that busy. It was rarely that I would have to come in. They have an emergency supply cupboard, so that all the nurses would know how to get into those ones. So if anything that's not available on the ward, they could quickly access into the emergency cupboard. So that would eliminate the amount of time that on-call pharmacists had to come in. You would rarely have to come in for on-call to supply, to take out medicines. With my trust, you might not catch up with your sleep at all. You might do on-call and having to go to work the next day. That's just the beauty of it. But you'd be surprised how much your body get used to it, and you just carry on working as normal. That was my experience working as a rotation pharmacist. I do miss the bounce back idea. So as a junior pharmacist, you always have a line manager or a senior pharmacist, could be your diploma tutor that you could speak to if you've got any questions, or you've got loads of pharmacists like specialize in different area that you can just speak to. But then you also working like progressing a lot as well as a NHS pharmacist. You moving as starting as a band 6 pharmacist, and then if you want to specialize in a certain area, you move applies for a band 7 post, and then down the line they're working through a framework to train you to become an advanced pharmacist. Some pharmacists moving to different trusts because see what's available, depends on what's available. Some start off could be a fixed term contract. If you like that post, you can apply to become a permanent pharmacist. If not, you can apply to different hospital across the country and see what's available to support you. First of all, completing your diploma. Secondly, we'll apply to do your independent prescribing qualification. So if I was studying, if I still stay at Scarborough, I would be right now, I'll be doing my independent prescribing in acute medicines, but because I hadn't decided to leave, I couldn't do that. So that might be something else down the line I have to look into, in terms of funding, in terms of having a supporting tutor or a doctor that support me having that completed. So what beauty about pharmacists is it's a variety of roles that you can try. That was my brief experience of working as the rotation pharmacist. My experience might be different to somebody else working at the bigger trust, like Sheffield or Leeds. I hope that there's some hints and tips there that you could find useful in your career, or it could be, you know, if you're deciding whether you would want to work as community pharmacist or the hospital pharmacist, you could see, you know, what's my day like, what's a day would look like working as a hospital pharmacist, and that may be helping you making a decision better going forward. So thank you very much for listening to my video. If you've got any comment, write down the comment below. If you've got any question, please put on a comment below, like and subscribe to my channel. And thank you very much. And I hope to see you again soon. Bye bye.